Having said that, it's almost time, so let's start our today's class. And right after the class, I will definitely send the YouTube link for all the videos to all of you, actually. But salam, peace, and shalom. Welcome back, everybody, to our regular weekly Interfaith Explorations class. Today, we have a special class because we don't have a guest speaker. Jay and I will be taking turns, and we are going to rely on you all too. So we are all co-teaching today. So to start today's class, I want to first take us back to a story that I shared last time about a rabbi who asked his students that how do we know the night has ended and the day has begun? And all the students gave different answers. One of them said, I know when I can distinguish between my field and the other person's field. The other one said, I know the day has begun when I can tell the difference between my house and the house of my neighbor. So they all gave different answers. But the rabbi did not accept any answer. And he said, your night has finished and your day has only begun when you can look at the face of another human being and recognize the common human element, and then recognize that he or she is your brother or sister. So I wanted to take you back to that story because it's interesting how our minds work. They're always thinking in terms of divisions, distinguishing one thing from another, separations, compartmentalizing. And this practice is, I think, cultural and also personal. Our whole history of the world is plagued with this dualism of mind versus body, God versus the world, science versus religion, male versus female, white versus black, you versus me, Muslim versus Christian. And we see that all the time. So building on our last class on unity, I decided to do today's class on the letter C. C for connection. The spiritual practice of connection, it erases all those arbitrary and sometimes these unnecessary distinctions that we have created among ourselves. And we need to engage in this practice when we feel that we have a tendency to compartmentalize our own life, our own experiences, and we put them in these tiny, neat little boxes instead of looking them at all of them as a whole. So this practice helps us see the world in a holistic way. It helps us see the bigger picture. I was reading the book Spiritual Literacy yesterday, and it said that one definition of spirituality is the art of making connections and knowing that everything is related to everything else. You practice connections consciously by linking those traces to other beings. And any place could be a good starting point. It could be with another student in this class. It could be with a neighbor, your family, your work. Relationships are important because they create the spiritual web of life and they give us a practicing ground to look at these connections. If you go back to religious traditions, I go back to Islam and whatever faith you belong to, you will see that most of the religions emphasize that our deepest values are expressed through these essential relationships. Sometimes they're the best training grounds because they provide us the opportunities to practice these soul traits that we have been talking about: joy, love, compassion, play, forgiveness, gratitude. But you know, at the same time, they also expose our shadow self. They help us draw out our anger, hatred, envy, pain, greed, shame, so much more. So connections through relationships are difficult, challenging, but important for our spiritual life. I'll share one small story of one of my connections. You know, I am a Muslim. I'm a devout Muslim. The word Islam means submission, and Muslim means the one who submits. And I have a practice of silence, in which I practice silence more than now. It's a long practice of silence, 2 to 3 hours every night if I can. I have been trying to adhere to my practice, but I haven't been able to. My teacher had been telling me for months that this is what I need to do for my spiritual evolution, for my spiritual advancement, but it's hard, it's challenging. So years ago, I think it was at least 6 or 7 years ago, I'm in a car with my friend, those of you who know her, Reverend Susan Sims Smith. This is the time when we met and we started doing interfaith work. We started giving talks on Islam and Christianity at different churches and organizations. So we are in a car in the morning driving to Arkansas Tech University. And we, two women, we have recently met, we could be no more different than we were. I mean, Susan's white, I'm brown. She speaks English, I spoke Pakistani. She is older, I'm younger. She is a devout Christian. I think I was a practicing strong Muslim. She's from America, I was from Pakistan. Very different. So we're driving in the car and we have a whole schedule of these talks set up that we are going to do in the next few weeks. And then Susan tells me that, Sophia, I need to change the schedule. I heard the call of divine in my dream last night that I need to practice more silence in my life. So every day, every morning, I'm going to spend 2 hours in silence. So I cannot do this work in the morning anymore. I'm like, Susan, we have a whole schedule set up for the next months to come. We can't cancel them. She's like, no, Sophia, I'm sorry. I heard this call and I must obey. I'm going to practice silence every morning for a few hours and I cannot work in the morning. No, I thought I'm the Muslim one. I'm the one who hears and who obeys and who submits. And here, this Christian woman, she heard a call and she immediately obeyed. Of course, I connected with her instantly over the spiritual practice of silence, which was very important for me. But I also felt envious. Maybe I felt small. Now, when I look back at it, I definitely felt scared. At that time, I didn't realize that. But I felt scared too. I know that now. Of the devoutness of or deep spirituality of this Christian woman who was beginning to inspire me. And I was not ready for that. I've been trying to submit to my call for silence for months and I couldn't do that. And she did it instantly. And my heart said, Sophia, Susan is a better Muslim than you are. That was a moment of a deep connection that I felt with her. It was disturbing in some ways. It was enlightening in other ways. And it led to a long, deep friendship that we have had and we will continue to have. And we grew spiritually in myriad of ways. But that moment was very, very important for me, that moment of connection, which was very scary for me, actually. So connections don't have to happen in with those strong, deep relationships. They can happen anytime. But those small moments when separation disappears, even for a short time, these are mystical experiences, and it's very important that we recognize them, we hold on to them, and we're not shy about naming them, even if it brings out our shadow self in us. And these connections can also happen in a doctor's office, in a grocery store, in a street, in a public park, anywhere. We don't need to wait for them to happen in a comfortable surrounding, but we do need to look for them and recognize them. So before I give it to Dr. J. McDaniel, I'm going to share a video of a song with you. The song which has continued to inspire me since it has happened. So there are small excerpts from this song. It was filmed back in 2018. Let me just give me a second so I can find it, hopefully. I thought I had it open. Yeah, so in 2018, in the honor of the historic visit of Indonesian religious leader to Israel, there's this group called Kululam. They hosted an event at Tower of David, and they invited 1,000 people to the Tower of Babel, to the Tower of David, people who have never met each other, who have never known each other, to a special event in which they all sang one song. They met for less than an hour, and within 1 hour, they sang one song in three different languages in three-part vocal harmony. And I think that song is a very, very beautiful example of connection among strangers. So let me see if I can share my screen. I hope I can. Jay, tell me if you can see full screen.
Not yet. I don't see any yet. Now it's happening.
Okay, is it full screen for you?
Not full screen yet. Go to the right, down to the square, other side.
Okay, let's see if I can do that.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Got it. Thank you.
Okay, we are back. And Jay, thank you so much for listening to the video. And Jay, you are on now.
So, Sophia, thank you so much. And I'll speak for just a little bit, and then I think we're going to open it up just for sharing among everyone. So please know I won't speak forever, but just a little bit. I think that the song, One Love, One Heart, probably speaks to a yearning that we all have. At some level, deep inside us, there's a yearning for one love, one heart. And sometimes people understand God in different ways, and some people aren't sure they believe in God at all, and that's okay. But for me, when I think of God, I think of one love, one heart that kind of embraces the whole of things, encircles the whole of things. So at some deep level, we're all included in one love, one heart, although sometimes we can't know, feel that. And so that would mean that God is not the least connected reality there is, but the most connected. And what makes God God is not that God is so immune and so separate from things, but so close to things and embracing things. In Islam, they speak of that as the nearness of God. So I've been thinking about connections for today, and it seems to me, and I get this from a tradition in China, that says we can be connected to four different things, and they're all important. And one is, of course, connected to other people. And one is connected with the more than human world, with hills and rivers and trees and stars and dogs and cats. And one is to be connected with heaven, however we understand heaven, to feel connected with something more, something larger than us, that one love, one heart. And also we can be connected with ourselves. And my own experience is that sometimes people are better connected at one level than another. I know some very loving people that are really connected with others, but sometimes I'm not quite so sure that they're so connected with themselves. And then I know some people that are really connected with themselves, but I sometimes wish they were a little more connected with others. And I know some people that are connected with people and with themselves, but kind of forget the more than human world. It's all about people. And I suppose there are some people that are connected with heaven to the neglect of the rest of the world. I suppose that's true. But all four are so important. The earth and other animals, ourselves, other people, and heaven, our God. And so it seems to me that part of the spiritual life is awakening to the connections that already are and breaking out of the illusion that we're all by ourselves. We're really connected to one another, whether we know it or not. And then part of it is then to do something with those connections. So I remember it's the Christmas season, and for Christians, I think we... This is a time when many of us will go to church. I will. My favorite service is Christmas Eve. I like to experience God in the night and in the dark sky. And so I love the hymn, Silent Night, Holy Night. That's one of my favorite hymns, carols. And I remember one time I had a friend, a family that belonged to our church, and the young son, he must have been in his early 30s, was suffering from cancer. And it had been a long, hard struggle for him. And it was tearing his parents apart and his spouse apart. It was so hard for them. And it went on and on. And so on one Christmas Eve service, I remember sitting up in the balcony of my church and seeing the mother and father walk in and sit down at their pew. And this was Christmas Eve. And they looked very, very sad and very, very worn. And I think everybody in my small church, we knew that. We knew what they were feeling. And we were glad they were there. But do you know how there can be times in a person's life when they're so sad, they can't sing, they can't pray? It's too deep for song, too deep for prayer. And so I remember when we sang Silent Night, and I was watching them, and I realized we were all singing. And in a very deep sense, we were singing for them. They couldn't sing, so we'll sing. I think prayer works like that too. Sometimes people can't pray. Okay, we'll pray you. We'll pray you. So singing, prayer, are ways of establishing and recognizing existing connections. And they enrich other people. They enrich us, to be sure. When we pray for somebody else, we're enriched. But those prayers, those songs become part of their lives too. And I think that's C is for connection. One thing I appreciate about Judaism, maybe Islam as well, it has been less inclined toward individualism than has Christianity. Jesus was Jewish. The prayer we learn from Jesus isn't, "My Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name." It's, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name." It begins with "our." It begins with "we." It begins with relationships. It begins with a sense of togetherness. So C is an invitation to honor and recognize the connections that already are. And if we need to be sung into fullness ourselves, let there be that singing. If we need to be prayed into vitality in times of darkness, let others pray us into existence. And let us do the same for them. C is for connection. That's it for me.
Okay.
For the next 2 minutes.
So let's go back and open, let's open the discussion for everybody. I'm going to give you two parables from our curriculum, the book Spiritual Literacy, to as springboards for this discussion. And one of them is a story by Rabbi Terry Bookman, and he tells us the story about a man who did not understand his connection to the people around him. So this man is sitting in a boat, and he began to bore a hole under his own seat. And when his fellow passengers asked him that, "What is he doing?" he answered, "What do you care? Am I not boring under my own seat?" And I want you to remember that, because we have this American image of cowboy rising in the, riding off in the sunset. And sometimes we become very focused on our own selves, that we don't realize the impact that we have on others. So reflect for a little bit about the moments when you did not feel the deep connection that you have with others around you, or how you have been boring holes in your life. And then the second parable I want to share with you before I open it for the discussion is from Dale Turner. And he tells us a story of a telephone operator in a small Cape Town. And that telephone operator received a phone call, a daily phone call, from a random man at exactly the same time. And this went on for many, many weeks. And finally, the operator asked the caller that, "Why do you call every single day requesting to ask me the time?" So that person would call every day to the telephone operator and ask, "What time is it?" So the operator asked him, why do you call me every single day? The caller responded and said, because I am the man who's responsible for blowing the siren at noon every day. Well, that's mighty odd, said the operator, because every day, exactly at noon, I set my clock by your siren. So this is such a simple story, but it's such an accurate parable of our life that we are dependent on each other, the way telephone operator was dependent on the siren of that caller, and that caller was dependent on telephone operator to tell him the time to blow the siren. So I also want you to reflect upon any relationship of interdependence that you have with someone in your life, and maybe praise them as we move into the holidays. But now let's open it for discussion. Anything about boring holes or stories of interdependence?
Thank you, first of all, for the cool alarm. That was just, can y'all hear me? That was just gorgeous and inspirational. And it really reminded me of some things that happened in the 80s, the mid 80s. I remember in 1985, we had the We Are the World, you know, celebration to try and aid, you know, people in Africa. And then I also remember Hands Across America for, you know, anyone, I guess, that was hungry. And that was in 1986. But I was looking up the lyrics to, let's see if I've got it still here. Well, anyway, the lyrics to We Are the World are really inspirational. Let me see, hold on. I was gonna read just part of them. Okay, hold on. I'm looking for lyrics, L-Y-R-I-C-S, which is so, I think, relevant today because of the pandemic. It says, there comes a time when we heed a certain call, when the world must come together as one. There are people dying, and it's time to lend a hand to life, the greatest gift of all. We can't go on pretending day by day that someone somehow will soon make a change. We are all part of God's great big family, and the truth, you know, love is all we need. We are the world. We are the children. We are the ones who make a brighter day, so let's start giving. There's a choice we're making. We're saving our own lives. It's true. We'll make a better day, just you and me. And, it goes on in the same vein. But I was thinking about those two events and how I remember how powerful they were. And I felt a real, you know, global connection of people asking others to help starving people, actually eventually around, you know, the world. And I remember the Hands Across America event. And I thought that was such an encouraging sign that throughout all the time zones, you know, people were forming a human chain with the hope, you know, and the resources, hopefully, that hunger could be eliminated or at least addressed in a better way, because we have so much of that just in the United States. You don't have to be a third world country to have poverty and hunger. But this song that you did with the that you played with the Kula Lamb reminded me of that sense of unity where strangers come together for a common cause. I mean, that was just exhilarating. And, you know, it seems like there might be something we could do today during this world pandemic of a similar vein that would really be profound and make people, even strangers, feel more united. That's all I have.
Does anybody think that maybe interfaith groups like this are or at least one way, one small way, but an important way of awakening to those more global connections. I mean, how do you experience interfaith community? What, besides personally satisfying, I know it's that, but is it a beacon of some kind of hope that you carry in your heart for a widening? Kitty?
I'd like to talk a little bit about my journey. When I was a child, I spent a summer in Mexico. Oh, I was raised as an Episcopalian, and a little girl in Mexico was very excited to meet me, and she said to her friends, "Look, she's Jewish." And I said, "No, no, I'm Episcopalian." And she said, "Same thing." Because to her, there were Catholics and there were non-Catholics, and that was it. And then back in the States, with my little friends, they said, "Episcopalian? Oh, you're Catholic." "No, I'm not Catholic, I'm Episcopalian." And so I spent a lot of time as a child trying to figure out the differences and the divisions. And, you know, when someone would say, "Oh, you're like Catholic," say, "No, no, we don't use incense." And later I found out that high Episcopalians did use incense, so I had to find something else. And I was trying to get narrower and narrower to find, you know, where do I fit? But then, getting a little older in high school, I found out more about my friends' religions. And my friend Marilyn was the daughter of a Nazarene minister, and my friend Karen was a Catholic. So I thought, okay, which one is right and which one is wrong? And I couldn't figure it out. They both seemed like nice people and my friends. And then I began to visit my friends' churches, and again, which one is right, which one is wrong? They're all talking about Christ. And then I began to get a little broader and find out about Judaism and eventually about Islam. And they're all talking about God. Why does the incense matter? Why does, you know, if you're wearing a hat or you're not wearing a hat, because it's God, it's one God. So when I began studying the Baha'i faith, I could broaden that instead of the little narrow thing. I could start to see that we all yearn for God. We're all seeking God. We're all trying to understand and trying to live by God's teachings. And there's not like these people are right and these people are wrong. So I really resonate with what you're saying about connection, and finding out that there are so many good people. When I traveled with Up With People, one of the songs was, "There are many roads to go. They don't all go the same way, but they get there all the same." And that was a lot of what I felt. You know, we're all so different, and yet we're so much alike, and we're on the same journey. Some people are taking a lot of side trips, but we are all reaching for God. So I'm just happy to be in such a positive group of people who understand that we're on a journey. That's all.
Meg and Anita.
So an image occurred to me as I've been listening to everybody. of and Liz Lucker will appreciate this most of all because she's a heart fanatic, but I'm picturing a large heart with a heart in the middle of it and a lot of color. Let's say a rainbow heart for lack of another image. Because we're all of one heart. Let's make it God or whatever you'd like to call God beating in the midst of this large, colorful patchwork heart. I'm done. Mic drop.
Anita, thanks, man.
I have to confess that one of the things that came to my mind as we listened to the song that Sophia shared with us is that wouldn't it be wonderful if that song could be played every time Congress meets, that perhaps they could get the message that we are one people and work for the greater good of all. How powerful would that be if that could be heard and absorbed and acted upon? So I had that one thought. I had the thought that from process theology too, that there's one race and it's the human race. We are so connected. And to Jay's question about do groups like this make a difference and matter, I think absolutely. To create the conversations we need to create, sometimes we have to start small and work bigger as we go. But to sit in our boats and bore holes all alone, as Sophia pointed out, doesn't do us too much good. But if we can begin to expand that even small groups, pockets of people with the same heart and the same understanding of connectedness, I think it begins to have a ripple effect. And we have to trust that energy can go way beyond our small circles. Because when you think about it, we each are throwing stones in the water and causing these ripples wherever we are in our peace corner of the world. So this one group is not just this one group. It's community within community within community. And so I see it being a profound way to reach out. And I have to say, during this pandemic time, it's been hard because we've been pretty isolated on purpose, of course, trying to be protective of everyone else, including ourselves. And I finally landed on a way to reach out beyond my boat through our church in Fort Worth. They're doing a congregational care ministry team, which is a support role to the existing ministerial staff, particularly with pastoral care. And my area is really grief. And so I have now 22 people on my little small circle that I'm reaching out to have had significant losses this year, a large number of them due to COVID. The most recent one this week was a young woman whom I know well, who had to say goodbye to her mom on a cell phone on FaceTime while a nurse was holding her hand. Now, hopefully with the vaccine and things that are coming, we will have a greater place to be in a few months. But right now, it's so hard. And I never thought about praying with someone being possible that well virtually. But my goodness, it is. Because connection is not bound by space. And so that has been a really significant way for me to know that like the guy in Cape Town, we're connecting, we're helping one another in ways that we maybe didn't imagine prior pandemic, but God's not limited by pandemics or cell phones or whatever else we throw in the way. That's it.
May I?
Please, yes.
Okay. Thank you, Meg. In my 70 years, I'm so grateful that I too was able to experience some of these milestones that people are talking about. I even still have my shirts from Hands Across America, and I will always remember where I stood. It was on 12th Street in Little Rock. having grown up back east in a town where I was a dirty Jew, mm-hmm. and I never understood, never embraced that concept, so to speak. And then I went to college in Boston, and I remember taking Religions of the World and being fascinated by it. At which point I think, I thought to myself, I don't get it. When a child is born, they're born to a family that observes a certain religion, and that child has no choice. They're raised that way, so what makes that right? And I always thought about that, and I thought, that's crazy. Nobody has the answer. Therefore, you know, we need to embrace everybody because it is what it is. I remember doing a research study on stereotypes when I was in college, and that was a pretty gutsy thing to do back then. And I learned a lot from that. And since then, I've had roommates who are of other cultures when I was becoming a professional and so on, and sharing as much as I could. And I think that's where that heart came from, Meg, is that I just don't get it. To me, it's all about love. And it's all about love or a lack of love. And when there's a lack of love, it's my job to try and instill love. So the connections that I've been able to make throughout my life, I think are quintessential to me and really my legacy. If there is a legacy, it needs to be about love. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else? Sheila. Sheila, yeah.
Am I unmuted? Okay. I had two things. One in response to Jay's list. Where did you say that list of connectivity comes from?
It's from China. It was written on a wall outside a city in China. And it was called the Fourfold. People, Earth, yourself, and heaven. Those are the four connections.
Right. And it struck me that when you were talking about that, that I have really gotten very good at the connecting with self and better over the years at connecting with others. And I think there's always been a connection to God, even when I faltered and didn't understand it or felt like I lost my way with that. It was there. God has been sort of the constant that I come back to. But the connecting with the non-human or what's the term?
I say more than human.
More than human. I like that a lot. That has really increased since the pandemic and the shut-in, which has been, it's sort of fascinating as it occurs to me now. But I think it's because I began to walk and notice things around me more. Flowers and trees. I've been taking lots of photographs of flowers in the spring and then trees as they began to turn in the fall. I've spent more time outdoors alone, which has, there's just been sort of a natural connection. And my husband, who has always been really more connected to the more than human world than he has to the human world, has always fed wild things like the squirrels and the birds and all that. And I was not home enough to really appreciate that before. But we have families of birds and squirrels and raccoons that he has almost cultivated as pets. They come up on our balcony and eat, and they, you know, they're really, they have become, which has just been lovely to me. And I've just picked up a book at the library called The Hidden Life of Trees, which is fascinating about how much trees connect with each other in their root systems and so forth. So I appreciate that. That has been a real revelation to me, is the connection that we really can have to the non-human world or the more than human world. I also meet with a group that was talking about my Dharmata meditation group from the Ecumenical Buddhist Society here in Little Rock, meets via Zoom now every Saturday morning. And while when we were meeting in person, I've been one to connect through silence in groups in ways that I was never able to connect or never had the same feeling about when we got into discussions and conversations. There's just such a deep heart connection when you're silent with other people that I have found to be so spiritually enriching, that I love. That was there when we met in person. But ironically, meeting on Zoom, that is still there, but we have discussions at the end because we're all wanting to sort of catch up with each other since we don't see as many people as we did before. And I've connected with my little group in such a way that I never could before, ironically enough, on Zoom rather than face to face. So that's one of the sort of silver linings, I think, of being shut in and being disconnected from my normal sort of activities in the world and finding these wonderful new ways to connect. And one other thing, our Dharmata group does every week, we're led by a teacher, a Buddhist teacher who sends us teachings online. And he does a loving kindness meditation, which is so valuable in the sense when you are talking about praying for other people, but you use the term praying other people instead of praying for other people. And the loving kindness meditation is similar to that. Is that it's an opening of your heart to other people, and it has kind of three parts where you visualize those you love and have compassion for them. You visualize those you struggle with or have trouble with in your life, send the same loving kindness to them, and then visualize the world. And trying to open your heart with compassion to the world. So those are the ways I've connected during this pandemic particularly. Thank you.
Thank you, Sheila. And we have about 9 minutes, Dan, please, yes. And then
I know we're running out of time, so I'll be brief, but Sheila's remarks about the trees reminded me of the trip we took out west. We were on a guided tour in Glacier National Park up toward the Continental Divide, and our guide pointed to the aspen trees along the road. And he said, "Now, I know you think these look like different trees, but really they're all one tree. Mm-hmm. They share a root system. And the trees at the top of the mountain absorb sunlight and transmit it all the way down into the shadows of the valley. and the trees in the valley absorb moisture and they send it up to the trees at the top that don't get much. And that concept that they were all one tree made me think about humanity being one. And really united through our souls, because each of us is a soul that's an emanation from God. And we're all united to one another from having been created from the same substance. And it reminds me of this very short passage I'd like to share with you. Know ye not why we created you all from the same dust, that no one should exalt himself over the other? Ponder at all times in your hearts how you were created. Since we have all been created from the same substance, it is incumbent on you to be even as one soul, to walk with the same feet, to eat with the same mouth, to dwell in the same land, that from your inmost being, by your deeds and actions, the signs of oneness and the essence of detachment may be made manifest. Thank you.
Thank you, Dan. And Sophia, this is our last session for a while. So can you bring it to perfect closure? And also remind us when we convene again and where we'll pick up.
Okay. Well, perfect closure, I cannot say. I want to read a very quick story before we close. So there is a story of this teacher who takes a map of the world and shreds it to pieces for a very obstinate and difficult student in the class, because he wanted to give that student an impossible task to do. And he shreds the map to pieces and gives it to the student to put it back together. The student takes those pieces away and comes back in 10 minutes and the map looked perfect. So the teacher asked him, "How did you do it?" And that student said that when I turned the pieces over, I saw a torn up picture of a man. I put him together, and then when I looked at the other side, the world was whole again. And this is a story which always reminds me about our interconnectedness with the universe. So I wanted to give it to you before we leave today. Now, firstly, I want to remind you that we will not be meeting for 2 weeks. So next 2 Wednesdays, we are taking off for holidays. Jay and I both are working on lining up an excellent line of speakers for you all. We will be meeting again on Wednesday, January 6th, and then we will have our regular 12-week session on spiritual literacy, and we will be covering some of the same but a lot of new letters with you all. So our next session will be Wednesday, January 6th. So please remember that. And I want to wish you all a very happy holiday, whether you are observing Advent or celebrating Bodhi Day or Saint Nicholas Day or Hanukkah with lights all around you, or you're going to be celebrating Christmas or New Year, or maybe you're not celebrating anything. You're just being with yourself or with the universe. But I just want to wish you a joyful holiday. And I wanted to close today's session with another piece of music, which I feel is very unifying to me, in which I have these Muslim singers who are playing some beautiful carols amidst all the light that reminds me of Hanukkah. So I'm going to play that piece as our closing practice today. And I will see you all in 2 weeks then. So here we go. Jay, please tell me if you can see full screen. Or whenever you can see full screen. Can you see the screen?
Yes, it's great. Thank you.